Very big welcome, and I suppose our speaker tonight probably needs no real introduction based on how many of you are here. But just in case you wanted him by accident, Peter's a writer for the Mail on Sunday, a World Prize-winning journalist, author of multiple books on a variety of topics, including politics, crime, religion, and drugs. And he's also a very experienced foreign correspondent, and tonight we're lucky enough to be hearing firsthand about his, but not only his experience, but from his unique perspective. So I hope you'll join me in giving him a very warm welcome.
I'm afraid she didn't mention that I also narrowly failed to gain selection to the Olympic team last year for the little-known sport of starting an argument in an empty room. I argued too much with the selectors. The simple points that I've come to make, I will make fairly briefly, because it is an argument that I really most of all want to have about Russia, about foreign policy, about liberty, about what should really concern us about other people's countries. But I begin by explaining that part of my reason for this is that, for better or worse, I've been forced rather to like both Russia and Russians. I spent 2.5 years living in Moscow at the end of the Soviet era, and I saw the communist regime depart and collapse in the middle of a coup. I had tanks coming up the street in which I lived, and I witnessed an awful lot of things that I don't think any of you will ever see, and I hope none of you ever will, because they have gone from the earth. But the Soviet Union in which I lived was genuinely an evil empire, genuinely a rather menacing and frightening place. I lived in a block of apartments on Kutuzovsky Prospect in Moscow, and my neighbours were mainly KGB men and members of the Soviet elite. The Brezhnev family lived across the courtyard, and it was clearly a place which was run very secretively, very brutally, and in an utterly privileged fashion. A small anecdote to illustrate the level of privilege which I gained simply by living in this block of flats. The Moscow traffic police, notoriously extremely corrupt, and if you had to, as I did as a foreign correspondent, drive through Moscow with special plates on your car identifying you as such, you were constantly being stopped and accused of driving at incredible speeds and asked to pay enormous fines, which were of course bribes. One evening, coming back from a press conference, I, very, very late on a snowy night, I ignored one of these patrols, thinking the heck with it. And unusually, they were quite lazy as well as corrupt, they chased me into the courtyard of the building. And they pulled up behind me, and they demanded my papers. And I gave them my papers, my passport with my Moscow residence permit and my Soviet driving license. And they shouted at me, "How dare you drive past us? How dare you ignore us?" And they threw my passport and my papers into the slush at my feet. And they said, "Anyway, what are you doing in here?" And I said, "I live here." At which point they stopped. The officer picked up my passport and my papers from the slush, handed them back to me, saluted, got back into his car and drove away very, very fast indeed, because he was afraid of me. That was the nature of the Soviet regime, as it was. Even a member of the royal family could have got that sort of treatment in this country at that time. That immense privilege. And there are all kinds of other things. You could go down into the areas where the gulag had been, and find people who had been prisoners under Stalin, still living in the towns in which they'd been imprisoned because their families had been wiped out while they'd been in the gulag camps. They had nowhere else to go, and they were still living among the people who guarded them. The place was a filthy slum of shortages and misery and corruption and laziness and dirt. And I hated it, and they all hated it too, and there was a film made which disgracefully has never been shown in this country, and this name will occur again in the conversation, by a filmmaker called Stanislav Galryukin, who was a friend of Alexander Solzhenitsyn. The film was called Tak zhit nelzya, which means roughly we can't go on living like this, and it took the Politburo to decide to allow it to be shown, and I went to see it in a cinema in Moscow in the summer of 1990, And everyone in the cinema was weeping because for the first time they saw the truth being told about the corruption, the desecration of the churches, the misery of their lives. And one of the scenes which was most striking was a long queue of people in a provincial city, respectable people dressed in smart, by Soviet standards, coats and hats, queuing up, waiting for the weekly ration of vodka on which their happiness pretty much depended. They looked more or less like a German, or perhaps an Austrian middle-class crowd, except for the background of horrible tower. And then the word came through, there was no vodka that week, and this crowd of respectable people descended into a horrible, spitting, snarling, punching, kicking riot. That was a measure of the desperation of the place. And the people saw this, they knew it, but to see it actually being publicly referred to by anybody, because it was never mentioned in the newspapers, it was never mentioned in the schools, it was never mentioned in political discourse, to see the state of their society mentioned, described in a film in public was enough to make them weep, to suddenly see the truth being told about something very evil. So I saw absolutely nothing but delight when it was swept away. On a couple of nights in August 1991 when the tanks came out and then the tanks withdrew and after that the Communist Party was over forever. So let me be absolutely clear in this. As far as the Cold War was concerned, I was a Cold Warrior, very much on the side of those who opposed the Soviet Union, who hated everything it stood for, who wanted it driven out of all those lovely capitals, the Prague and Budapest, and Berlin, and those people liberated and allowed to live their lives instead of being crushed under a horrible secret police empire. So let us have that all clear to begin with, and then skip a few years now to the arrival of Vladimir Putin on the international scene, and the elections which were taking place in Moscow in February of last year. And the whole of the Western media and all of Western public opinion ceaselessly backing Alexei Navalny and all the critics of Putin and saying it was time he was swept away, and backing these white ribbon demonstrations in Moscow and saying this is a bad man, he should be got rid of. And I simply couldn't find myself in agreement with it, because there were two things that I knew. One, that Russia is not the Soviet Union. That Russia does not in any way threaten this country or Western Europe or anyone really except its immediate neighbours in any way. It has no interest in an ideological battle for control of the world. Talk of a new Cold War is so much tripe. There is no such thing intended. Nothing, no desire in Russia to expand in that direction. It's false. Secondly, I thought, why of all the tyrants, and I still travel in the former Soviet Empire, in Kazakhstan, in Uzbekistan, or come to that in China. Why of all the tyrants in that part of the world are we so particularly concerned about Vladimir Putin? And it came to me in a simple flash of revelation as I walked down the snowy street that I used to live in, thinking, what is this? Why are we having this conversation? Why this hatred of Putin? Why does everybody who knows nothing about Russia think this man of all the despots in the world should be overthrown? And it came to me, it's about national sovereignty. Russia is the one major country in the world which is not a superpower, but which is still prepared to assert its sovereignty, that is to say, its desire to govern its own affairs, to run its own economy, to run its own politics, to pursue its own foreign policy, to run the kind of government which it itself chooses to have. And it sets itself completely against the new ideology first set out by Anthony Blair in a famous speech in Chicago shortly before the Iraq War. The new philosophy of the modern West, which is, if we don't like your regime for any reason, we will somehow or other start a war against you, overthrow you, and replace you with somebody else. This, as we all know, has been an immense success. Look at Baghdad, one of our early experiments in replacing the existing government with a new one. And there's nothing wrong at all with what happened in Baghdad, apart from the fact that the country is almost split into three. That it is constantly plagued with kidnapping, explosions, terrorism, and disorder in a failed state. And is effectively a failed state, as is Libya, where we intervened a couple of years ago. As were it not for the presence of foreign armed forces, would most of Yugoslavia be. And as Syria is, thanks to the intervention which we contrived to begin, but cannot finish. This seemed to me to be immensely important because of another experience I had. Now, you may say, I don't much care if someone starts intervening in Yugoslavia, or as it was, or in Syria, or in Iraq, or in Libya, or in Egypt, or any of these faraway countries. You know, it has absolutely no importance to you at all. But the principle has actually been applied here, and could be applied here again. And I will tell you exactly how I know this, because I was also living in Washington in the early 90s, at a time when Gerry Adams of Provisional Sinn Féin was trying to become an important political figure, very much against the wishes of the British government. And I knew, because a good friend of mine was a correspondent of the Irish Times, exactly how much more powerful in the councils of Washington, our supposed closest ally in an alleged special relationship, how much more powerful in the councils of the White House and the State Department the IRA were than the British government were. That Gerry Adams was given his visa, that Gerry Adams was given his seal of approval, that Gerry Adams was allowed to tour the United States, raising funds and posing as a friend of civil rights by an American government which was determined to force this country to surrender to IRA terrorism in Northern Ireland. And I remember speaking with an official, a very senior official at the White House, about this, who'd been told off because she realised that some of the British press were not happy with this treatment. And she said, as I talked to her, she said, well, don't you think it's right for us to intervene in Yugoslavia then? And I said, do you seriously compare, there in the West Wing of the White House, do you seriously compare Britain, your closest ally, a long-standing member of NATO, a law-governed democracy with hundreds of years of history as a constitutionally governed state, do you seriously compare Britain with Yugoslavia? And there was a sort of silence, because that's exactly what she was doing. The United States believed that it had just as much right to intervene in our affairs when it suited us as it did in the affairs of Yugoslavia, or later on in Iraq. And it seems to me that this principle of national sovereignty was one which was worth standing up for. If my own country hadn't done so, then I would very, very much be pleased if somebody else did so. And I thought that Vladimir Putin was coming under all this pressure, was being threatened by a colour revolution. Possibly some of you will remember the supposed Orange Revolution in Kiev, or the Rose Revolution in Tbilisi in Georgia, which were largely, in my view, contrived by Western money to overthrow governments by what would, under any other circumstances, be called mob rule, which is dignified by the modern media as people power. And I could see that something of the kind was being contrived for Vladimir Putin. And as the Syrian crisis proceeded, and as various governments, including our own, fought harder and harder and harder for a military intervention in Syria, which would have created, in my view, a terrible war, and turned the country already in very, very serious crisis into much, much worse crisis of chaos. I thought, again, this principle of national sovereignty is one which needs to be defended. Vladimir Putin is not merely defending it in his own country, he's defending it in Syria and in the Middle East. He's saying this idea that you can intervene in somebody else's country because you don't like its regime is one which is wrong, dangerous, and should be opposed. And anyone who's seriously concerned with international stability, with peace, for ending this strange period of voluntary war which we entered into in the early years of this century, should actually be very interested that there is somebody who's prepared to take this line. Now, I know about Sergei Magnitsky and about the appalling treatment of that man in a Moscow jail. I know about Pussy Riot. I know about Khodorkovsky, I know about all the other things which Vladimir Putin has undoubtedly presided over, which are unquestionably wrong. These criticisms are unanswerable. But I also know that there are similar criticisms which could easily be made of several other countries, notably the People's Republic of China, where we currently have a very high-level delegation grovelling for trade and favours. And that the idea that you can be principled about the wrongdoing of one regime and have no principles about the wrongdoing of another, suggesting that you don't actually have any principles at all. That if these reasons aren't universal reasons, they aren't your real reasons. And that we should begin to examine this constant urge, propagandized by academics, propagandized by politicians, propagandized by our own Prime Minister, propagandized by the BBC, that there is a duty in this country, and a duty in all major countries to intervene in the affairs of foreign countries. It's time it came to an end. Putin stands against it. That's why I like it. That's what I came here to say. If any of you want to argue with me, I'm here.
I guess this means we're open to questions, so go ahead.
Isn't Putin intervening by supplying Syria with weapons?
Certainly Russia does supply Syria with weapons, but I think it's just as Russia has a vestigial naval base at Tartus and various other connections. But I don't think that these are major concerns. Actually, from what I can discover, the Russian government does not have very good or friendly relations with Syria. Its decision to protect Syria from international action is not because of a liking for that regime or because of any hope of commercial gain, but because of a general feeling that if this principle of national sovereignty is not re-established, then the next country to go will be Russia. And in an era when this is probably the major development of our time, look, just go back to 1649 for a moment. There was in 1999 an international celebration of the 350th anniversary of the Peace of Westphalia, at the end of the 30 Years' War, which we'll of course all know. And the reason for this was that this was the moment in which great powers of Europe had said, in future we will not intervene in the internal affairs of other countries, because the 30 Years' War had devastated most of Europe. Most of Europe looked like a Hieronymus Bosch painting at the end of the 30 Years' War. The population of Europe had gone down significantly. Great cities had been reduced to ashes. And the idea that you intervene in other people's countries because you didn't like their religion and their internal beliefs was thrown out of the window. And suddenly, almost immediately after those celebrations were over, we now move into a new era where all the lessons of the Peace of Westphalia are being thrown out of the window, and we're now justifying intervention in other people's countries without apparently any knowledge of history. It's not to do with arms sales, it's not to do with naval bases, it's to do with that principle of sovereignty.
Position on boycotting the exchange of Russia?
What's
your position on boycotting the exchange of Russia?
I don't really believe in boycotting games. I'm not terribly interested in games or sports myself, but I don't really believe that it achieves anything very much. And the boycotts, the partial boycott of the Olympics in Soviet times didn't actually achieve a withdrawal of the Soviet Union from Afghanistan. It's gesture politics. If anybody individually, as a matter of conscience, wishes to boycott anything, as far as I'm concerned, they should be supported. Any act of conscience should be supported and sympathised with. But for governments to make boycotts seems to me to be almost a direct contradiction of that. You can't have a government-sponsored conscience. Your conscience has to be your own. So individuals who feel that it's something they don't want to do, quite right, and that's their decision. But governments doing it, I think, is largely futile grandstanding and of no value.
The question would have been, what is your take on the hypothetical situation? If, let's say, tomorrow the government of the United States says that they need to go and protect their citizens in Syria, however many of those that might be there, and see that as a reason for intervention. And if, I mean, the reason I'm asking really is a reference to 2008 Georgian War, really.
A reference to the
2008 Georgian War, where the Russian...
The Georgian War, yes, it's very interesting, Georgian War. I think it's possible... This is another very important question here. Most people think that the Nuremberg trials of the German National Socialist leaders were about the massacre of the Jews. To some extent they were, but the principle those trials were intended to establish was that it was no longer possible under international law for anybody to wage aggressive war. And that was the principal crime for which they were indicted, and that was the principal change in international law which resulted from it. So the main effect of this has been to restrict the right to wage aggressive wars to the great powers, which have one way or another been able to ignore or circumvent the United Nations rules. You could find a way, I expect, to circumvent those rules. But I think that, in fact, the chemical weapons allegations, still, in my view, not fully examined, let alone proven, against the Syrian government in Damascus, were an attempt to circumvent them. But I think that they so lacked popular support in the United States, and indeed congressional support, that so failed to convince, that I think another pretext of that kind probably wouldn't work either. The Georgian War is interesting because of the very strange American and European Union presence in the Caucasus, where they have no historic ties or business being, and where anybody who has any sense who lives there knows they won't sustain themselves. It's as if Vladimir Putin started, as the Soviet Union used to do, setting up and influencing governments in Central and Latin America, trying to set up cordons of allies along the borders of the United States. It's actually quite provocative diplomatic activity.
But in a way, Vladimir Putin, being the champion of sovereignty, did invade Georgia on the basis that there was this internal problem in Georgia going on, and Russia said openly, publicly, that it felt it needed to go there in order to protect their citizens, which you could argue is an intervention.
My understanding is that Saakashvili initiated the military action on that occasion, and it may have been a very useful pretext to the Russians, but they did enter Georgian territory, but they didn't remain on Georgian territory. And there are all kinds of disputes there about Ossetia in particular, and Abkhazia, which are more complicated than I think anybody this evening wants to get into. It's the Schleswig-Holstein territory, but they are. The fact is that the Russian forces entered Georgia and then left, and have not made any effort to return to Georgia since then. Even though it's the view, I think, of almost every serious Russian diplomat and politician that countries in the Caucasus, as well as Ukraine, Belarus, will eventually return in some form to the Moscow orbit, and I think they're probably right. They're not going to do it with military force. Anyone else? Yes, please.
Do you believe we'll see any Russian intervention if the US was to attack Iran?
Who knows? I really don't think. I'm one of those people who doesn't believe that Iran has a serious intention of constructing nuclear weapons, and I'm also one of those who is tempted very strongly to believe that the new Iranian president is actually pretty much what he appears to be. But Iran has, since Britain and Russia used to more or less partition Persia, has been a Russian sphere of influence, for the obvious reason that it's on the southern borders of the Russian Empire. And if there were any American intervention there, I can't see Russia standing back. But I think the idea of an American intervention, a direct American military intervention in Iran, is probably at the moment more distant than it has been for some time. I certainly hope so. One of the reasons for that is precisely that it could trigger a much more serious conflict well beyond the borders of Iran. And the fact that there are other powers who would be interested in that and would object to it, I think, is one of the reasons why a diplomatic solution is more likely.
What if Israel was to?
I think Israel will do what the Americans let Israel do. I think an Israeli government that acted independently of the United States in Iran would not last very long. I don't think the Americans would permit it, and I think that the pressure which the United States would place upon Israel diplomatically and indeed financially is so huge that I would be amazed if I know Mr. Netanyahu is noisy on the subject, but I think I would be amazed if he took unilateral action against Iran. Yes, please.
Is Putin's decision to issue Edward Snowden with a visa not counterintuitive to what you were saying about interfering with the US's business?
I think it's not a direct interference with the internal affairs of the United States. It's a hostile act, no question of that. But I think that he would probably, if you had him here, say that it was quite minor compared with the many hostile acts which he believes the United States has taken against Russia. It's not an aggression onto American territory, and it's you might call it passive aggressive rather than anything else. I don't think it really qualifies as a casus belli. Yes, please.
I can kind of see the view of you don't want intervention in other countries. However, that wouldn't make me like Vladimir Putin because of all of the wrongs that he's done, like you said. And it seems to me that you can agree with his view of not intervening, but I don't think it's fair to say he's doing it because he wants peace in the world. I really think it's partially for selfish reasons. He doesn't want intervention in other countries because he thinks that it will lead to intervention in Russia, and what best spot would want intervention in their own country?
Well, I agree with you about selfish reasons, completely. I think the selfish motives are the only ones you can rely on, especially with powerful nations. I think it was Palmerston who said that countries don't have eternal friendships, they have eternal interests. And they will act selfishly, unless they're governed by irrational idiots who act selflessly, which usually leads countries into all kinds of disasters. So I don't in any way accuse him of idealism, which is something I deplore anyway. Idealism usually ends in disaster. Utopia can only ever be approached across a sea of blood, and you never arrive. So the less idealist politicians are, the happier the world will generally be. So no, that's not a question of... I think if his policies are followed, I think there will be more peace and less war. We wouldn't have had the Libyan war. We would not now have... I mean, two other consequences of that. We would not now have a state so failed that its own prime minister can be kidnapped in the streets of his own capital. And if he'd been kidnapped in Benghazi, I don't think he'd have been released. And one of the other consequences, though, of course, is this tragic uncontrolled mass immigration across the Mediterranean, which the Gaddafi regime, for all its many failings, was controlling and preventing, which does no good to any of the people taking part in it, let alone to the countries where those people arrive. So a bit of cynicism and a bit of selfishness in foreign policy is not a bad thing. Generally, it's much more likely to have benevolent results for ordinary people trying to live lives, raise families, and do their jobs, than utopianism, idealism, and what Robin Cook used to call ethical foreign policy. Yes, please, at the back.
Can you give your opinion on Putin's pursuit of the war in Chechnya and the vast human rights abuses and disappearances that Russian forces were accused of that?
Oh, I think the Russian armed forces are absolutely horrible and savage in their behavior. I think that the way in which they've conducted that war is despicable, and one feels a lot for the victims of it. I only say an important point here: when Boris Yeltsin, who was actually in most important terms a Western patsy in the Kremlin, was pursuing a war just as brutal in Chechnya, if not more so, it didn't attract anything like so much criticism. So, when this criticism arises, you have to say, is it really about the war in Chechnya, or is it really about the fact that we don't, or the US State Department, the British Foreign Office, and the KPLC don't like the actions of Vladimir Putin? I think because they were more or less silent about Yeltsin's Chechen war, that it's because they don't like Vladimir Putin. They couldn't care less about what goes on in Chechnya, and they're making it up. But that's just my own opinion.
Did it not be better because Yeltsin lost the war, so
there
was no to criticise
him? Well, maybe. I mean, I think fundamentally the method that he lost it with roughly the same methods that Putin is used to winning. I suppose Putin was more competently brutal than Yeltsin, but that's not really a moral question, is it? Yes, please.
Is there ever a line with intervention that you think can be crossed and intervention is justified? And if not, what is the role of the UN war crime?
For me, I'm against it completely. I just think that on principle, I think countries should run themselves and they should be allowed to run themselves. I know there are examples. The Vietnamese intervention in Cambodia, the Ugandan intervention, Tanzanian, I think, intervention in Idi Amin's Uganda, and possibly Sierra Leone, though that's not over yet, where you can make a case and say that it was benevolent in its effect. I know that you could say that in Rwanda, if an intervention happened, maybe people would have been saved. That I've never seen a practical plan put forward for how that intervention would have happened. I just have to put up with that. that it's possible that sometimes by failing to intervene, terrible things would happen which are avoidable. I think that the principle of leaving people to get on with their own affairs inside their sovereign borders is so important that you might have to sometimes stand by and let horrible things happen. Whether there is such a thing as international law, I'm not sure. There's a very interesting book by Michael John Laughland about the political trials, starting with the trial of Charles I in England, moving on to that of Louis XVI in France, and tracing a line of these trials through to the modern international court trials. And there is something very suspect about it. I do recommend it. It's a fascinating book, and it tells you lots of things which you thought you knew and don't. And my feeling has been for a long time that if despots knew that they could escape with their money to Saudi Arabia or Switzerland or some bolthole, they would be much more likely to leave power than if they thought that they would end their days in a cell in The Hague, or as Charles Taylor is apparently going to do, somewhere perhaps in Belmarsh. They won't go if they think that they will be imprisoned. They will go if they think that they won't be in prison. And I think it's the law of unintended consequences at full stretch. The current fashion for locking up despots actually makes despots hang on to power much more grimly than they otherwise would.
So Russia has been protecting Russia through non-interference because they want no intervention in their country. But what makes Putin do that? Because of what is he frightened? Like, who should intervene in Russia? Is he saying Russia is not frightening any other state anymore?
I think a lot of people look at what happened in the supposed Orange Revolution in Ukraine, and look at what happened in the supposed Rose Revolution in Georgia, just as examples. And ask yourself how it is that so many people found themselves equipped with orange flags and orange jackets and so forth in Kiev, and how there came to be a rose revolution in Tbilisi. And wonder to yourself whether anybody outside Kiev and Tbilisi might perceive to be involved, whether anyone had any interest in that. What Putin undoubtedly fears, and that's why he set up the rather grotesque movement called Nashi, which you're doubtless aware of, what Putin undoubtedly fears is that somebody, some open society organization, NGO or whatever it's called, will foment some sort of white ribbon revolution of the kind which seemed to be taking off in Moscow in February of 2012. And if that could be done, and if the crowds could be got on the streets of Moscow in sufficient numbers, and got sufficient coverage from the Western media, he could be overthrown, it's perfectly possible, by perhaps a renewed Yeltsinist regime, because a lot of people outside Russia benefited a great deal from the Yeltsin regime, which pretty much let them plunder the place. I said I'd mention Stanislav Galarykin again, because during the 2012 election campaign, I noticed that he was taking part in it. He was this man, this friend of Solzhenitsyn, this foe of the Soviet regime, and of corruption and oppression, actively campaigning for Vladimir Putin. And do you know what he said? He said, under Yeltsin, this country was sold. It was sold to foreigners, sold to corrupt people. The corruption was completely outrageous. Under Putin, we have returned to normal corruption. And that, for anybody who knows anything about Russia, is an easily comprehensible statement, one which is absolutely true. Corruption is normal in that country, and at the levels it was at under Yeltsin, and the level of plundering, particularly by foreign investors of the country under Yeltsin, was huge. And I think there are a lot of people outside Russia who would like that plundering to begin again, and I think Putin stands against them. I think that's the fundamental reason why he feels under threat. Which raises the question of Alexei Navalny, who is lionized and made much of, I noticed by writers in the Guardian newspaper. If they read carefully Navalny's thoughts on the people of the Caucasus and his description of them as cockroaches and his talk about shooting people, then I think they would be less enthusiastic. But they blind themselves to the nature of Alexei Navalny because they're so completely disposed to be against the Putin government that they will not see any faults in his opponents. And this is, again, it's just this thing. If you were really, really, really a democratic person who believed in the rule of law and a liberal society, you wouldn't like any of the players in modern Russian politics. None of them is actually significantly better than Putin on those terms. And it's, and you simply can't overthrow Putin on the basis that once he's gone, he'll be replaced by a Russian equivalent of, shall we say, Barack Obama, because no such equivalent exists. Yes, please.
I don't quite understand how you can be against taking national sovereignty from the country and be supporting Russia when are they not trying to prize the economic and political sovereignty from their neighbours?
One of the troubles with liking Russia is that you become, as I have, as much as I am a British patriot, something of a great Russian chauvinist. I don't myself believe that the borders into which Russia was forced at the end of the Cold War were just borders or correct borders or sustainable borders. I think that there was almost all Russians believe that the deal which Gorbachev struck with the West was that the Soviet Union would be broken up, the Soviet domination of Eastern Europe would end, the Soviet attempt to counter the United States power as an ideological world would come to an end, but the country, which was then the USSR, would remain largely as it had been. And then I remember James Baker coming very, very triumphantly to Moscow late during my time there, and more or less announcing that Russia was going to have to lose its power over what Russians term the near abroad. And there's been a very aggressive move by the European Union and by the United States into the Caucasus and into Ukraine, less so in Belarus, which is a more complicated case. And many Russians believe that what's happened is quite similar to what happened to their country in 1917 under the almost Carthaginian peace of Brest-Litovsk composed by Imperial Germany after the German high commander sent Lenin to Petrograd to overthrow the government. And they believe that those borders are unjust and unsustainable, and they don't regard these neighbouring countries as foreign countries. They regard them really as part of their own sphere of influence, and they will eventually restore that. I think they will. I think the force of nature will restore Russian domination over those areas. There's a huge tussle going on over Ukraine at the moment, and I think it will. In the short term, it will tend towards the European Union, and in the long term, Ukraine will end up in the Russian sphere of influence again, simply because that is the way it's bound to be. But if you look, it's the great unexamined treaty of modern times, the Brest-Litovsk Treaty of 1917. You will see in it the foreshadowing of the humiliation of 1990 and 1991. And Stalin's Russia reversed Brest-Litovsk. Putin's Russia, I think, will reverse what happened in 1991. Yes, please.
Hi. You talked a little bit about how you brought about idealism and how are you distinguishing between that and principle?
Principle is I think a form of absolute morality. Some things are always wrong, some things are always right, and your actions should be guided insofar as humanly possible by that. Idealism, I would say, would be the belief that there is that human society is in some way perfectible, either in terms of international politics or domestic politics, that there is a utopian model, say of world government a la Star Trek, or of an egalitarian society domestically, which can be and ought to be pursued and is preferable to pragmatic, take it as it comes, limited amelioration sorts of politics. I think that's the distinction. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, thanks. they go further back.
Do you think it's possible for Russia to move on from its more like autocratic past to a more democratic and democratic structure?
I'm not all that in favour of democracy anyway. But it seems to be a very dodgy idea and hasn't proved to be very successful where it's been tried. But liberty and law seem to me to be the most... In fact, this is an interesting point. When the Soviet regime collapsed, people rushed into Moscow and said, you must have democracy and you must have a free market. And two results of this. One, the economy collapsed. The other, there is a... I have to be slightly rude here. The many, many Russians now don't say demokratia when they refer to democracy. They use a slightly different word, demokratia, which means, and I won't be as profane as it is, it means the rule of excrement. And that is how democracy, so-called, is regarded by many, many Russians. The era in which they were at their most democratic was the era of plunder, corruption, gangsterism, people being forced out of their homes, losing their jobs, the debauching of their currency. Everything awful is associated in their minds with it. So I think the chances of that in the near future are pretty slender. The other problem about Russia is where it is. I think this is true, and I've checked it with Russian friends. I don't claim to be a brilliant Russian linguist, but you will probably have heard of the KGB, the initials stand for Komitet Государственной Безопасности, the third word, Безопасности, meaning security, but it's not a proper word. Без means without, опасность means danger. The word for security in Russia is not a positive word, it's an absence of danger. And the reason for that is not hard to see. The country has no really defensible physical borders, which is why for most of its existence it's been an army with the country rather than the other way around. For instance, there is a street in Moscow called Balsha Ordinka. It's where the Israeli embassy used to be, which translates as the Street of the Great Horde. It is where the Golden Horde used to turn up every 5 years to collect their tribute. It's a frontier country, it's a frontier city, it's a frontier culture, and it's very much on the edges of Europe and civilization, always under threat from one thing or another, within living memory, horribly invaded by the Germans. It's that, on that insecurity, I think the enormous power of the Russian state, the willingness to accept levels of repression which we would find intolerable, rest. And until you can resolve that, I don't think it's very likely that it's ever going to be governed in the ways, say, that Britain or the United States can. You tend to find that stable, free, law-governed societies are surrounded by water or protected from their neighbours by high mountains or deserts. They're not in the position that Russia is in, a sort of corridor for invaders. And I think, I doubt it. I would like it to be so. A lot of Russians I know would love it to be so. But there is a great and very notable civilization there, particularly a literary one, but I just don't see it as likely in the near future. Please.
Do you think you like Putin more with regard to his international policy than his domestic policy?
Yes. Quite simply, that's what mostly concerns me. I don't. The internal policy of Russia are, by definition, in my argument, Russia's business, not mine. Though it is an interesting fact although it's undoubtedly true that any serious political opposition to Putin is ruthlessly crushed, it's probably easier to speak your mind as an individual in modern Russia than it is in modern Britain, particularly if you work in the public sector in modern Britain, where if you transgress various rules of equality and diversity in conversation, in a state school or in a state-run hospital or in a local authority, you're quite likely to lose your job. I don't think that happens in Russia. It's a very interesting paradox and one which I think people should think about quite hard. But no, I'd love to see the renaissance of Moscow after the death of communism. I think it's probably the city in Europe that I most enjoy being in, but it has horrible aspects to it, which I think are are indefensible, and I don't defend them. But in terms of foreign policy, I think it makes a very important contribution to the peace of the world. Yes, please.
Do you think that the Russian foreign policy is moving in the right direction in terms of achieving greater influence in world politics? And is the creation of the Eurasian Customs Union and the SCO the right steps taken in that direction, counterbalancing the Western influence in world affairs?
I think there was a very, very large Russian foreign policy success over the attempt to start war in Syria. And I think that the performance of Sergei Lavrov as a foreign minister was a demonstration to the world of what genuinely informed, historically informed, and serious-minded diplomacy can achieve in a difficult time. I think if Lavrov hadn't been involved, quite possibly we would have had a Western intervention in Syria with all the horrible consequences that would have followed. I don't know about the Eurasian business. I think that there is a huge realignment coming. You only need to look at this extraordinary thing. You go to the Russian Far East, and on one side of the Ussuri River are dying Russian cities where the birth rate is lower than the death rate, and the buildings are empty, and the factories are piled with rust. And on the other side of the same river are huge, growing Chinese cities expanding by about a square mile a week, full of people. And how much longer China is going to be prepared to tolerate Russian occupation of territory taken from it in the past when it was weaker, which Russia isn't even doing anything with, I don't know. The future relations between Russia and China are one of the big, unexamined diplomatic perils of our time, but I really don't know how that's going to go. I hope, as I think everybody must, that whatever happens, it's peaceful. Yes, please.
Returning to an earlier point, you condemn the use of foreign intervention and sanctions against despots, but
yes.
In the absence of both, how does one remove violently oppressive governments from power, or at least curtail their action?
One does.
It's not happening in effect in the country.
Yes. Well, here we touch on a delicate subject, but the Second World War was not actually fought by those countries which began it, or indeed by those countries which finished it, because they had any objections to the internal government of Nazi Germany. It's one of the great myths of modern times that the Second World War was an idealistic war. It was nothing of the kind. There's a whole evening we could spend on discussing this. But one of the problems of this great myth, which is constantly raised, is that, for instance, the Second Iraq War. George W. Bush and Anthony Blair imagined themselves to be reborn Winston Churchills. They portrayed Saddam Hussein as a new Hitler, and Iraq's Ba'ath Party as equivalent to the German National Socialist Party. We know perfectly well, of course, that neither Mr. Blair nor Mr. Bush was a reborn Winston Churchill. I don't know quite who in past history they could be equated with, but certainly not him. And I think any sensible person also knows that Saddam Hussein was not really Hitler. But this pattern, repeatedly imposed on every international crisis, Anthony Eden did the same thing during the Suez Madness. He claimed that Nasser was a dictator equivalent to Hitler. It's all based upon a myth about the Second World War. We did not fight, and you might argue that we should have done, but we did not fight against the nature of the National Socialist regime. When the truth about the mass murder of Europe's Jews was brought to the attention of the British Foreign Office and the American State Department, they ignored it and did nothing. The principal ally in the eventual defeat of German National Socialism was Stalin, who, if not as bad as Hitler, was so nearly as bad that any claim that the Allied side in the Second World War had any moral character seems to me to melt away. It's a myth. That's not what happened. If internally bad regimes are the concerns of their own people, if they want to get rid of them, they can get rid of them themselves. And if they don't, then they don't. But it's not our business to intervene. Sorry, it's your turn now.
Considering Russia's very sovereign and national, do you think there's a place for Russia, or indeed anybody at all, on the UN Security Council?
Well, I'm very glad that Russia and China are on the US Security Council at the moment, because the structure of it means that they've been able to prevent foolish things from happening. I think it's one of those where, as W.H. Auden said in a different circumstance, why spit on your luck? It might not be the arrangement that I would have designed, or anybody would design, but it worked out well for the world in general, that there's somebody capable of restraining David Cameron when he goes barking there. And on that occasion, it was Russia. So I can't really complain about it. I wouldn't myself, if I were left to design the world myself, it wouldn't include anything called the United Nations. But it's there, and on that occasion, it performed a useful function. So I'm not going to criticise it. Yes.
Just going back to the question before, if you were in charge at the time, would you have let the extermination go on?
At which time?
Or no, at the time of the Second World War. So well,
this why it takes a whole other evening. The policy of the Hitler government towards the Jews of Germany was between 1933 and 1938, largely one of appalling persecution, insulting behaviour, deprivation of privileges, and all kinds of other revolting things, but it was not extermination, nor was it openly, generally murderous, particularly on the part of the state. After Kristallnacht in 1938, when the state sponsored the murder of large numbers of Jews, it switched. But the main purpose of it up to that point was actually the expulsion of Jews from Germany, not their extermination. The policy of extermination was not conceived of, nor did it begin, until after the Second World War had been in progress for more than 2 years. Whether there is an argument, which I'm not even qualified to have and not prepared to have this evening, whether it happened because of the war, whether it happened because the war gave Hitler the chance to hide what he was doing, which he wouldn't otherwise be able to do, I don't know. But it is certainly the case that it is difficult to conceive of how he could have embarked on that policy if there hadn't been a war. And it's also the case that the Kindertransporten of Jewish children leaving German territory, and which saved many, many valuable lives and was one of the most effective ways of rescuing Jews from the Nazis, ended the moment Britain and France declared war in September 1939, and many people died as a result. And secondly, the conduct of the war by Britain and France, incompetent and as it was, between September 1939 and May 1940, led to the occupation by Hitler of almost all of continental Western Europe and the deaths of hundreds of thousands of Jews who fled from Hitler or who were living in those countries and would not have feared him otherwise. So there is a question here as to whether the extermination of Europe's Jews there's no question it wasn't actually taking place before the war began. There's no question that when the chancelleries of the Allies discovered it was going on, they did nothing about it. There is a question as to whether it can be said that it was the cause of it, but it's much, much more complicated than Hitler was exterminating the Jews, should we have intervened to stop it? That's all. It's not a question that can be given a direct answer to. It is the case that the one exception in the United Nations Charter, the one overriding exception to the rule against intervening other people's countries, is actual genocide, a word which I think is quite often misused in modern times and applied to things which aren't actually genocide.
Do you agree with that? Because if you don't think we should...
In theory I agree with it. In practice, the way in which it's used makes me suspicious of it, because there's this... Then there is this tremendous struggle to label as genocide things which plainly aren't the equivalents of the mass murder of the Jews, and therefore to use it as a pretext. I don't know whether anybody will ever attempt to do again what they've attempted to do in the final solution. But I do know that that false parallels are made with it an awful lot of the time as pretexts for war. And I also know that although no one, I yield to no one in my horror at the deaths resulting from Hitler's policies, but one must also examine the hideous deaths of millions of people as a result of the war that was fought. No one actually knows how many people died in the Second World War, particularly in the Soviet Union. What they do know, in many cases, is that how they died was appalling and unpleasant. And very few people in this room probably know, though there is now a fine book on the subject with the title Orderly and Humane. I can't remember the name of the author, but Orderly and Humane will bring it up for you, about the Potsdam Agreement and the mass expulsions of German women and children from the lands of the East after the war, in which untold numbers of people died hideous deaths, when we had guaranteed that no such thing would happen. So the horror of war, during and after, is immense. And if you're going to start one, you have to recognize that you might be responsible for that, and your pretext for war might turn out to be smaller than the horrible consequences which it causes. It's worth thinking about. It's not a balance that any sane person can weigh, but it's much, much more complicated than something bad's going on, we can intervene. Intervention itself is tremendously complicated and by no means invariably successful. Please. Yes?
I think for the argument so far, you've made a clear distinction between internal and external policies of a state. In reality, do you think that distinction truly exists? Because I think a state which has no regard for human life within its own borders is not likely to drop out at the border. And I think as an international community or collection of states, we do have an interest in the attitudes and approach of governments towards their own populations, because they do have a propensity, and I think the German experience you referred to is instructive in this regard. The aggression of Germany towards other nations and the policies that are adopted internally aren't really distinguishable. They were part and parcel of the same approach.
Oh, I would disagree with that. And I'd ask you to give me an example. I mean, you say countries have no concern for the lives of anybody in their borders. And where will you be thinking of?
I suppose my argument is, you've said that you're against intervention in any circumstance.
Though I recognise that this puts me at a disadvantage in certain, recognise that this debars me. Certain aspects, I would be very tempted to take out of the power to do so. Yes.
Certainly, yeah. My argument is that, do you not think there are certain actions within the borders of a state that may be pursued by that government which go beyond setting its own laws on social policies or taxation and actually go to the core of what it means to live as a human being in the world? I'm not talking about this in any kind of idealistic international humanitarian sense. What I'm saying is, by definition, certain types of government are a threat to other states because of how they act internally.
Well, first of all, there is the problem of consistency. If you wanted to look in the past century for examples of countries in which horrible things had happened, in many cases denied and unreported at the time, one could go to the post-revolutionary Russian Civil War, you could go to the massacre of Armenians by the Turks, you could go to the appalling man-made famines and other massacres of Nazis in China. Now, some very fine work being done by Michael Oetker about the murderous nature of the Maoist regime from the very beginning. These are all examples of terrible things which went on while the world stood back and did nothing, for the simple reason that either it didn't know. I didn't mention there are the Ukrainian famine, largely Ukrainian famines in Russia in the early 30s, which we didn't know about. Either we didn't know or we weren't prepared to intervene in them because we were too weak to do so. And then there's the other point, which I strove to make earlier, which is that many of these terrible things, in fact, probably most of them, actually happen during wars or as a direct consequence of wars. And that wars themselves create the conditions in which horrible massacres and repression, the driving of people from their homes in starvation conditions and therefore their mass deaths happen. because of wars, and therefore to use war as an instrument of policy against, let's call it for shorthand purposes, genocide, maybe simply using mass death as a cure for mass death. So I'd hesitate. I mean, it is difficult, and that's the whole point of discussing it. It's worth discussing, because if it was simple, then it wouldn't need to be discussed. I just think that from what I've seen in the history of the past 100 years, it seems to me that the argument repeatedly made in modern times that intervention is simple, easy, and good is false and misleading, and has led to a great deal of bad things which could have been avoided by not intervening. Yes, please.
So far we've been really talking about.
Could you shout it?
We've been talking about humanitarian intervention, right? People who stays have.
Well, so-called humanitarian. That's how.
Yeah, so-called humanitarian. People who stays have protect themselves.
Yes.
What if this transnational terrorism? Do we still have the right to protect ourselves?
Give me an example of what you mean.
Let's say terrorists come from Saudi Arabia. Do they have the right to go there?
Oh dear. Well, I haven't noticed. I mean, it is an interesting thought as to where terror comes from. I haven't noticed any attempts to invade or bomb Saudi Arabia lately. I mean, it's a. What can I say?
Absolute sovereignty thing.
You tempt me again into territory I'd rather steer clear of. But I think that people will use terrorism in other people's countries as a pretext for intervening in countries they want to intervene in anyway. But they won't intervene in countries they don't want to intervene in or dare to intervene in. So I think the great task is penetrating the disguises in which history advances itself. Is this the real reason, or is it a pretext? And I think the answer is, on so many occasions, it's a pretext. And terrorism is probably the biggest pretext for doing bad things in the modern world. Yes, please.
You outlined your sort of moral disgust with the Soviet Union at the start of the talk. Wouldn't that, if we sort of followed your rules about sort of no intervention, or I'm not really sure quite what you mean. I mean, I'm thinking maybe there were forms of pressure which helped bring the Soviet Union down. I think Reagan was in fact sort of Cold War anything. Certain things America did in terms of foreign policy to pressurize the Soviet Union. Wouldn't it still be around if we sort of followed your doctrine?
I certainly am now, and looking back, I like to think that I was always more concerned about free countries recognizing the dangers of revolutionary idealism. The real problem with the Soviet Union was that it had various reasons. Again, following war, largely, it had chosen the path of revolutionary idealism. Many of the original Bolsheviks were extremely nice, charming, gentle people, filled with love and brotherhood towards their fellow man, but they ended up slaughtering their fellow man and cramming him into concentration camps because of the remorseless logic of their creed. And I think that was the great warning. As for bringing down the Soviet Union, I often regret that it happened. I think that certainly the position of this country much deteriorated since the end of the Cold War. Our position in Europe is much weaker and much more vulnerable to pressure from the European Union. The American alliance is much less important and protects us much less. If the Cold War was still going on, for instance, the United States government would never have backed the provisional IRA against the British government, as in the end they did. That would not have happened. So, and also there are, for anybody who knew the Soviet system and sees what's happened, particularly to certain parts, the poorer parts of the population, and indeed the professional middle classes in Moscow, in many cases their lives have grown significantly worse as a result of the bandit capitalism which replaced the former system. So the fact that the former system had many things wrong with it doesn't necessarily mean that what's replaced it isn't necessarily any better or more desirable. And it's another illustration of the complexity of intervention. Our fundamental attitude towards the Soviet Union, if we believe in sovereignty, is that it's a warning, don't go down this road. It's a warning, that we should prevent this genuinely new empire from dominating Western Europe as it dominates Eastern Europe, and we should do that by force and diplomacy. And that's what I believe we should do. But any belief in actually intervening in the Soviet Union to overthrow the Soviet government would, I think, have been folly. And I think that in many ways the collapse of the Soviet government has been quite bad news for a lot of Western countries, notably our own. Yes, please.
Do you think there should be international aid? Or should countries, I guess, just look after their own, both say like Syria or like the Philippines that just had their earthquake, or should walk after?
Oh no, I think international aid is entirely justified. I think one has to be very careful how it's spent and who spends it and who gets their hands on it. It can actually do harm. You'll know about the work of Peter Bauer on this, that his characterization of a lot of aid is the poor of the West being taxed to give to the rich of the third world. And that is often the case. So aid properly targeted is excellent and not and good, but aid must be very carefully targeted. And it also, insofar as possible, it should be kept out of the hands of the local government, which will often misuse it, sometimes in quite spectacularly evil ways. But no, it's a different question. Sending aid to people when they've been the victim of floods, earthquakes, or famines is quite different from sending an army. Yes.
Do you think it's right for a state to act to preserve its own national sovereignty, but in doing so infringes on another's national sovereignty? So, for example, around Syria, there are a lot of states that may be destabilised by the last few flows of refugees and terrorism and weapons.
And what are you suggesting?
So, you're saying that a state may infringe on another's sovereignty or preserve its own. Not a bit of a
problem to our... Risky, I think. I guess it has a bit of the sound of the pretext to me. What guarantee would there be that if, say, Israel intervened in Syria, to me a terrifying prospect actually, but if that were to happen, that Syria would be stabilised? I think probably the main result would be to unite the government and the opposition against the Israeli invaders, but I'm not quite sure who else. Turkey has, in my view, intervened quite substantially in Syria. And done itself quite considerable harm by doing so. And probably the worst mistake that the Erdogan government has yet made, and it's rebounding quite badly on the equivalents of the Alawites in Syria, the Alevi in Turkey, and now are quite worried about their position there. So dangerous, and it has the sound of a pretext. I think it's better to let things work themselves out. The belief of the German military theorists of the 19th century that the only mercy in war is a swift victory. And I'm not entirely sure they were wrong. I think the best thing that can happen once the war has started is for it to come to an end as quickly as possible with a sustainable resolution of the conflict which began it. And intervention on the outside tends to prolong rather than shorten war. Yes, please.
Do you not think that the UK government should think about the conditions of other countries and like what's happening domestically there when constructing a trade policy with them? And what are your thoughts on like sanctions against other countries in order to effect change rather than intervention?
Well, I tend to be against sanctions because they usually have their greatest impact on the poorest people in the country that's targeted. They had a disastrous effect, for instance, on the not just the poorest either, but sometimes the people most want to be on good terms with. Government elites could always prove themselves against sanctions. But one of the things which we did in the sanctions we had on Iraq during the long period before the first Gulf War was to destroy the Iraqi middle class, which had previously been extremely pro-Western, actually very pro-British. And a very strong restraining power on many of the sort of things which happen in Iraq now. So I'm very unwilling to support sanctions. They seem to me to be posturing by politicians who rarely have much considerations to the effect they'll have. But if sanctions were imposed on this country, it wouldn't be the government or the plutocrats who would suffer. It would be you and me and the poorer people. And that's what always happens. I think sanctions are a very a very sneaky, sort of willing to wound, fearing to strike, way out for politicians who are being told by newspapers or some other pressure group that something must be done, but who don't care to make war but want to make a gesture, and it's often more damaging than, far more damaging than doing nothing.
Were you against them in South Africa in the 80s?
Were they against what?
Were you against them in South Africa in the 80s?
I couldn't make up my mind. It's very difficult in all these things. You can be against, as I think any civilized person was, the arrangements in South Africa, without necessarily desiring that South Africa should head in the direction which it's now heading, which seems to me, certainly from what I read and from what I've experienced on visits, to be in many ways quite serious for the inhabitants of that country. It's the application of utopianism. Something is bad, but do you know that you can replace it with something better? I don't know how many people in this room could rewire a house or do the plumbing or build a wall that wouldn't fall over. And I certainly imagine very few of our politicians is capable of even making a Lego model on Asia. Why these people think they can reconstruct an entire country at a distance of several thousand miles, I really don't know. It's a big business rebuilding a society, and it's very difficult to get it right. Yes, please.
What's your opinion on amnesty?
I think amnesty does an immense amount of good, and provided it limits itself to its original purpose. I joined Amnesty many, many, many years ago, and had taken part in the letter writing campaigns and all the other things. And I thought that its original incarnation, when you made sure if you wrote a letter to the Kremlin about somebody in the Gulag, you also wrote a letter to Chile about somebody in Pinochet's prisons, and there was no taking of sides, was a vital part of it. It couldn't be accused of being of having an alignment. I'm not so sure that that's true anymore, and I regret its increasing politicisation. I think, for instance, its campaign against the death penalty in the United States is entirely misguided. Whatever opinion you have on the death penalty in the United States, which is irrelevant to this, it's not to do with prisoners of conscience, and it engages in a public argument which is different. So I think the more they stay out of politics and the more they concentrate on doing individual good, as William Blake said, the general good is the resort of the scoundrel. Real good is done in minute particulars. And the great thing about Amnesty was it did do real good in minute particulars. There was somebody who'd been sitting in a cell for years and years without any idea that anything was happening at all, and suddenly he began to receive letters from outsiders, and the people who were imprisoning him received them too, and he was often released. It worked. And I think that's fantastic. But as so often, it's so much easier for these organisations to become political pressure groups, grandstanding, preaching for the supposed general good and forgetting the minute particulars. I think it's important they stick to those minute particulars. I think you've been before, haven't you? Anyone who hasn't had a go? Well, yes, please.
The death of Litvinenko affect your opinion of Putin?
How does he?
The death of Litvinenko affect your opinion of Putin?
Badly. I think we have still an absence of a complete trail between Litvinenko and the state there, whereas the Magnitsky affair is much worse because Magnitsky died under the direct control of the Russian state, and there's no question of that. And I think probably the worst single block on Putin has to be the Magnitsky case. And I think if I were giving an absolute condemnation of anything that government had done, and whenever I write about this, I'm absolutely clear. I don't hesitate to attack all these things with complete rigor and say that they're wrong. I think the Magnitsky case is much, much more convincingly pinnable on the Russian state itself than the Litvinenko.
What about Anna Politkovskaya?
That's again. It's difficult to actually to show a direct cause, though it's very suspicious. You can't, looking at the case, help but wonder whether there was some state involvement in the murder of Bolotovskaya. But I don't know. That's why I said, in the case of Magnitsky, it's absolutely up and shut. This is a regime which will do dreadful things, and has done, and I don't doubt they'll do again. The question is whether this blinds us to other qualities of it which are praiseworthy. Yes, please.
In terms of your non-interventionist stance, what do you think about countries where it seems to be proven that they can't get rid of their own dictators or sort themselves out, like Somalia or Congo?
Actually, Somalia, which I had the, I don't know what the word is, which I visited, on the eve of an American intervention, actually. This would have been, I think, 93, just before Christmas, when George Bush Sr. sent the Marines in. And I was standing on the beach when they arrived. And the Navy SEALs were in the bushes. And when we went to talk to them, they were very rude to us, because they thought they were invisible and they were embarrassing. And then a press officer of the Marines appeared and said, "Will you all stand here, because the invasion's going to come in there?" And so we stood here, and then the invasion came here, and they were all shouting, "Get out of the way!" So I've seen an intervention in Somalia, and it was a complete failure. And it was a complete failure on top of serial interventions by several Western powers in that country, which had caused the chaos into which it fought. It was intervention by the West, often Cold War-based, and by the East, in Somalia, which had turn it from a relatively civilized country into a disastrous failed state. I mean, I saw I arrived at the airport and was greeted by a group of 14-year-old boys with AK-47s offering services as bodyguards. And I turned to the man who came in with me on the plane, who knew my position. I said, "Do I accept this offer?" He said, "Oh yes, you don't have any bodyguards. You'll be dead and stripped by morning." And so I hired these 14-year-olds and drove around these blasted streets, everything mud, puddles, rubble, ruins, desolation. And when I got home, I was shown pictures of the same streets about 30 years before, with pavement cafes and uniformed policemen directing the traffic and telephone kiosks to smart cars. And in a very, very short time, foreign intervention had turned a relatively civilized, stable and prosperous country. And Somalia is a tremendous people. Some of the people who helped me there, I will never forget the human qualities of them, but there just isn't anything there. There is no structure there, and it's because of intervention that it's like that. Whether any intervention could now succeed, I don't know. I was myself distressed when the Islamic courts seemed to be ensuring some sort of order. I didn't like the look of the Islamic courts myself. Wouldn't want to live under them, but they seemed to be achieving the restoration of order in Mogadishu, and suddenly they were classified as being connected to Al-Qaeda, and initiatives were launched against them. So again, the hope of stability seemed to me to be ripped away. I may be wrong about that. I'm not an expert in Somalia. I just know what I've seen, and every time I read about it, I'm concerned about it because I have seen it. But intervention can cause chaos.
But you can't leave the chaos once it's there. You can't just...
Well, we have. We have. When the American Marines, who are a fine fighting force, though they shot at several British journalists on arrival, but they're a fine fighting force, and very brave men, militarily extremely competent, and they were driven out by General Idea. Their intervention was a complete failure, and everybody should read Black Hawk Down, the description of how it failed and what a disaster it was. Intervention, as I say, is very difficult. People think it's partly a television problem. Television crews are constantly being airlifted in remote places, and people think, well, therefore, if you can get a television crew into and out of Sarajevo or Damascus or Aleppo or wherever it is, then you can get an army in. Well, you can sometimes get an army in, but it might take 3 days to get an army in somewhere, but it might take you 30 years to get it out again. And in that time, it may have become the target of the people you went there to save. As it very often happens, look at the troops which Harold Wilson sent into Belfast and Londonderry in 1969, who was still there 30 years later, and had become the enemies of the people they'd come to help. Intervention is complicated. It's not, you can't just press a button and intervene and make things good.
Thank you.
Given some of the people who've had it, it would be hard to say who's necessarily ruled out, but I'm not on the committee. I mean, it's a satirical. Have you heard of Tom Lehrer?
I read that there was
rumours
about it.
Tom Lehrer, the great satirical songwriter of Harvard University and other places, said on the day that Henry Kissinger was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize that satire had nothing further to say. So I suppose, why not? But I mean, happily I'm not. Happily for me, happily for the world, happily for the Nobel Committee, I'm not on it. Yes, please.
Forgive me, I think I've had some trouble following the argument. So it seems to me...
Sorry to hear that.
One is about whether, in principle, it's right to intervene, you know, to encroach on another nation's sovereignty and so on. And then, if you like, there's a separate set of things about whether it's pragmatically a good idea to do so. And it seems to me that perhaps the conclusion that you're arguing for is the one that it's in principle bad to encroach on another nation's sovereignty. But it seems to me that the kind of reasons you've been giving us have been for the other, which is that often we don't have the right kind of information for it to be pragmatic for us to intervene. Or often people give the wrong kinds of moral justification when actually they're motivated by immoral justification or something else.
No, it's surprising how often principled actions turn out also to be the practically successful ones, and quite gratifying sometimes. But I think if you have a principle, it flows, in my view, from this belief that the nation state is the largest unit in which it's possible for human beings to be effectively unselfish to one another, to organise themselves under jointly agreed laws and customs in such a way that they can create a civilization, and that therefore the sovereignty of the nation state and its security from intervention by outside forces is itself a good to be desired, and one from which this country has benefited enormously. And so from that principle, then I say, if I don't myself wish to be intervened in, then I can't really, on the same principle, allow myself to intervene in other countries. I can then give you, because most people regard intervention idealistically, they quite rightly, they see something horrible going on and they feel the desire to do something about it. The comparison is often made, you see someone over there being mugged, would you intervene? I hope so. I have done, but it got me a black eye and no good. But I'm not sure I'd do it in the days when knives are more common. But it is a simple thing, and you're quite likely to fulfil your intention by doing so. But the problem is that intervention in foreign countries isn't as simple as intervening in a mugging. It's about 5 million times more complicated, and the outcome is much more unpredictable, and the outcome is very likely to be bad. So not merely is there a good principle for saying don't do it, because if you don't want it done to yourself, you can hardly do it to others. There's also good practical reasons for those who find that principle onerous and repellent, which I don't blame people for finding. It's not necessarily attractive when someone says there's evil going on over there, but I think you shouldn't intervene in it. This is not courting popularity here. But is that clear? I know we tabloid journalists do tend to be quite confusing and verbose, but does that answer the question?
Yes, but not very
well. Well, okay, in that case, I'll have to put it on somebody else. I think it's up to you.
Do you think scientific culture should be improved, especially Japan or Taiwan or India?
If I have it right, you're asking whether I think the United Nations Security Council should have other members apart from the
yes.
I think it inevitably will, right? Because I don't think the existing membership can be, which is based on the position in 1945, can be sustained. But I think that it would be difficult to create a Security Council as small and therefore as effective as the one that we have now, because so many people would vie to be members of it. As I say, I myself don't really favour the existence of the United Nations. I think it is in itself an implicit attack on national sovereignty, its very existence, and I'm not sure it does if I'm fairly sure it does more harm than good. But I think what you talk about will happen. I think, for instance, that the European Union will eventually demand a seat, and that will create great difficulty with seats held by Britain and France. I think that at some point or other, the United States will try and remove the Russian seat. But it's a battle yet to come. I think it's inevitable that it will. I don't really have any opinions on whether it should.
Okay.
Yes, please.
If you think that we shouldn't intervene in other countries, do you think we should have armed forces at all, apart from maybe abroad and with Coast Guard?
Oh, no, very much so, because armed forces are to deter attacks on you. And particularly if you are an island country, which is incredibly dependent upon the freedom of the seas for its existence and prosperity, you certainly need a strong navy. And I would say you needed an army which was capable of undoubtedly capable, and was known by any potential enemy to be capable of fighting a pretty considerable battle against an invader. So yes, I would certainly like to see a very comprehensive defence review in which our armed forces were redesigned for those purposes, because at the moment they seem to be a mixture of power projection in distant places, interventionist forces, and leftovers of all kinds of dead ideas, and also a covert way of protecting certain British industries by giving them contracts. So no sovereign country should neglect strong, effective, modern armed forces from a deterrent point of view. They should be so good that nobody wants to risk fighting them. Anyone else?
Well, Sabine sort of previously claimed territory, so for example, in the South China Sea, where you've got thousands of islands and waters there, which are being disputed by China and multiple other countries, which don't have a categorical answer for that, in the sense that they're both disputing the same thing. What happens with sovereignty there?
I don't know. A distinguished journalist known to me recently travelled for a certain publication, which I can't name, to that part of the world, examined the Spratly Islands and all the conflicts there, and said that he thought that the Far East currently resembles Europe in 1913. And that there are all kinds of conflicts waiting to boil over. I don't know. I hope that the countries involved have the sense to resolve it diplomatically. But I think there are major conflicts possible there, but it's a separate question.
Yeah, I'm sure the principle of certain authority over sovereignty, therefore, there isn't where's that going?
Well, it doesn't stop you negotiating over where your sovereignty begins and ends if the alternative is war. And war is hell. And you only resort to war when you absolutely have to. And diplomacy is absolutely essential. But diplomacy will not be effective unless you're capable of fighting war. I think it was Frederick the Great who said that diplomacy without armed forces was like music without instruments. So you have to have that, and the threat of it has to be there. But that's why you need grown-ups in diplomatic posts. And I have to say, I don't think that our current foreign secretary is particularly grown-up. I would like to see somebody rather historically informed and level-headed in the job. And in general, I think that would be good. But one hopes, after the horrors of the of Manchuria and the Chinese Civil War and everything else that were inflicted on the Far East, and indeed the Japanese invasions of so many countries after 1941, one hopes that there won't be any problems there. But it's not, the sovereignty issue doesn't necessarily need you to have war. You can avoid it. And indeed, Europe between 1815 and 1914 avoided it very successfully.
Just to say, we're on passage of time, so we could just have one or two more questions.
I'm afraid. I think we're nearly done. Yeah. So could I, who really, really wants to ask a question? Okay, you, and then that'll have to be it. So you first, please. Could you shout, because I'm not going to do it. No, not in its current form. I think in its current form it's a ludicrous Cold War weapon. I think we should keep a nuclear capacity, but it should be much more modest. And it there's no need to have these patrolling submarines and this vastly expensive multiple warhead thing designed to baffle the Russian or the anti-ballistic missile screen around Moscow, and that's all it's for, which is enormous and which used to get very much in the way of us having picnics in the woods outside Moscow because so many of the woods had missile batteries in them and the police would come and chase us away. We have absolutely no need to bomb Moscow. I can think at the moment of no circumstances in which we would need nuclear weapons, but I, on the other hand, I recognise that it's possible that we might. So we should maintain the capacity to make warheads. We should examine the possibility of ordinary aircraft delivered missiles or perhaps cruise missiles. The main thing I learnt about nuclear weapons during the Cold War, which included for me a weekend spent in a Polaris submarine, is that the whole point of them is that they must never be used. But their possible use must simultaneously be credible. The reason for Polaris and Trident was to make those weapons credible against the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union no longer exists. We don't need weapons that were designed to deal with the Soviet Union. So a much reduced nuclear force would be perfectly wise and practical. And then we also have more money to spend on effective conventional forces, which actually in our time of life would be much more useful. The other thing we would have money to spend on would be nuclear power stations, because the energy threat, actually very successfully used by Vladimir Putin against Ukraine, the energy threat is a much, much greater one against this country, and it's a much more usable one than the threat of nuclear weapons. And it's you.
You mentioned in passing that you are very keen on democracy. I'm just wondering if you think that it's the worst system until you try to think of a better one, or if you,
Well, it's interesting. It seems to me that what really makes our lives different from those in repressive countries is not the right to go into a booth every 5 minutes and be treated as a thief and illiterate, be given a pencil which is on a string so you can't take it away, and asked to write a cross because you can't write anything on a piece of paper which names several people who have already been chosen by other people, one of whom will win the election, whatever you do. It doesn't seem to me to be a particularly attractive proposition. I haven't voted for years. I regard it as a waste of time. I don't go into shops and buy goods I don't want, and I don't go to polling booths and vote for parties I don't like. But leaving that personal feeling aside, the characteristics of those societies which have been most successful, which have had the most free speech and thought, which have had the most freedom of action, which have allowed their subjects or citizens to develop as human beings, as people of conscience, have been countries in which freedom has been the principle, and freedom as embodied, for instance, in both the English Bill of Rights of 1689, the Petition of Right, Magna Carta, the American Bill of Rights of 1789, and these of 17, actually earlier than that, wasn't it? These, which are documents which don't talk airily about vague, nebulous rights, but which set upon governments limits and say government may not do the following things, and that's what those documents are immensely valuable. And also jury trial, which prevents the state being wholly in charge of whether anyone goes to prison. Jury trial is an immensely precious possession, which we don't defend anything like enough. Worth to me 500 times as much as the vote, and now actually very much under threat in this country. These are the important distinguishing marks. These are the things which have made the Anglosphere the immensely successful series of free societies without torture chambers or political prisons, which they are. Democracy is a very recent experiment. In fact, the original US Constitution did not allow for an elected Senate because the Founding Fathers specifically wanted to protect their upper house from what they call the fury of democracy, and they wanted to emulate the House of Lords. And the US Senate wasn't elected until, as far as I recall, the 17th Amendment passed in 1913, just as this country didn't become fully democratic until the Representation of the People Act of 1948. It would be hard, it seems to me, to say that either the United States or Britain were not free at times when they were not fully democratic. So I think there's one other small point about this. Anybody who's visited the People's Republic of China and who visited Hong Kong will note the immense difference between the two in the freedom of speech before or after the handover. Freedom of speech, rule of law, corruption, and also the general cleanliness, efficiency, and quality of government, public services, and everything else. Hong Kong has never been democratic, but it has for a very, very long time been free. And this is, again, the distinction. And I'm the confusion that people make between democracy and freedom, as if they were the same thing, is extraordinarily lazy. Democracy can, and often does, threaten freedom. It's democracy which enabled the passage, for instance, of the Homeland Security Act in the United States. It's democracy which has enabled the equivalent supposed anti-terrorist legislation in this country, which has hugely curtailed our liberties and hugely increased the power of the state, because democracy can be panicked into unwise decisions. So I think people should just learn to distinguish between freedom and democracy. Liberty from the state, the serious legal limits on the power of the state, the fact that the law is above power, that there is a genuine rule of law, these are the jury trial, the presumption of innocence, these are immensely precious possessions. Democracy, frankly, you can keep it. That, I think, will have to be the end. Thank you.